Today's daf we're going to be learning is Bava, Kamma, Pehe. It's pretty long daf, so we're going to try to get through it quickly without too many other added comments, but let's get started. So we started yesterday with this idea of the Mishnah. The Mishnah says, Tzal, what is Tzal? When do we pay Tzal? And it gave this example of burning someone, like even on their nail. That's a case where there is no damages. So the Gemara wants to know, whose opinion is that? And in order to figure out whose opinion, they bring a machloket, which is very unclear machloket, and we're going to see three different ways to understand the machloket between Ben Azai and Rebbi. And the way it's going to work is our Mishnah is going to match Ben Azai according to the first interpretation and Rebbi according to the second two interpretations. So the first we saw yesterday, I'll just review it. What we know it's a fact is that Ben Azai says in the pasuk, if you remember, there's a pasuk, kviya tacha kviya, petza tacha petza, chabula tacha chabula. So we're not interested in the petza tacha petza right now. We'll get back to that later in today's talk. We're interested in the first verse, the first phrase, and the last phrase. And what they're going to say is, Rebbi says, kviya ne'emra t'chila. First in the pasuk it says kviya. And Ben Azai says, chabula ne'emra t'chila, which literally means it says chabula first. Now it doesn't say chabura first. Chabura is at the end of the pasuk. They're not having a debate about what the order of the pasuk is. So what exactly are they discussing? First interpretation, and I'll just review it from yesterday outside, and then we'll start reading after that, is that when Rebbi says what they meant is, when it says a burn, it sounds like just a burn without a chabura. But then when it comes at the end, it says chabura, it comes to explain the kviya that was mentioned in the beginning. So that means that it's going to be only if it has a chabura, okay? Meaning only if you also cause damage. If there was no damage, then there's no payment. To which Ben Azai says the exact opposite, and that's our Mishnah. That it says, when it says chabula ne'emra t'chila, what it means is, when you see the word kviya, burn, you normally think of burn with a wound. And then when you see the word chabura all of a sudden at the end of the pasuk, you realize, oh, wait a minute. If it only mentions chabula now, it must mean the burn in the beginning that we thought was with the chabura actually must be without a chabula. And then the chabula part is adding if there's a wound. And then you would have a case where you would have tza'al without damages and you would have to pay, and that you learn from kviya tacha kviya. That's explanation number one. We're going to start with the words matkif la Rav Papa. Rav Papa now attacks us. It's about six lines from the bottom. Adababa, ifcha mistabra. What do you mean? It's the reverse. It means the opposite of what you thought. Rebbi, when Rebbi says kviya ne'emra t'chila, what he meant to say is this. Now we're going to basically put Ben Azai's words into Rebbe's mouth and the reverse. When he says, it says, that meant when it says kviya in the beginning, we thought it meant kviya with a chabura, with an injury. But when you get to the end of the pasuk and you see chabura, you realize, oh, wait a minute, that must be coming to change what we thought originally. And really, kviya is by itself, and chabua is with a wound. So from there, you learn the Rebbe holds that there's a payment for tsar even without damages. And that's our mission. Ben Azai omer, chabura ne'emra t'chila. Ben Azai says, no, it's chabura that it said in the beginning, meaning, savar, kviya delepe chabura mashma. Kviya sounds like there is no wound. And then it adds chabura at the end to tell you, oh, the kfiya that we were talking about in the beginning is only if there's also a wound. If there's no wound, then no. And that is against our Mishnah. So Rebbi would be the one matching our Mishnah according to this. The only thing left to explain is why did Rebbi then say kfiya ne'emra t'chila and Ben Azai said, chabura ne'emra t'chila, which it actually should be the reverse. Amaskana kaima. What it means is not t'chila in the beginning. T'chila here means the conclusion. The conclusion is, and that's Rebbi saying the conclusion is kviya by itself. And Ben Azai says the conclusion is kviya with a chabura. And that's why he says chabura ne'emra t'chila, meaning chabura is the conclusion. They're each talking about the conclusion and not what you would have thought. Okay, so that's like a switch in what this word tchila means here. Now we get a totally different explanation, a third explanation. They actually all think that when you see the word kviya, we assume any kind of burn, whether you injure them, whether you didn't injure them. But what's the machloket if so? Hacha bichlal uprat hamruchakim zemize kamiflege. Well, what you have in this pasuk is a klal uprat. Why? Because kviya is general, meaning they all think kviya could be anything. Chabura comes to define it and say only if there's a wound here. Okay? Only if, or you could say bruise, only if there's a bruise. Okay? So now, if you, what's the issue though? There's petza tacha petza in the middle. So there are klal uprat that's distant because there's something in between. So the question is, do you use this as a klal uprat, which then says, and remember what a klal uprat, then we say it's only like the prat. So then we're going to say it's only if it has a wound. So now we're going to say, Rebbi savar ein danim oto b'klal uprat. We don't rule it by klal uprat. And when he says, kviya ne'emra tchila, right, you would have to say, kviya im chabura. Remember, in other words, he says, because what did they all held, if you don't do a klal uprat, right, if you start with, kviya is going to include anything. So kviya ne'emra tchila, and kviya includes everything, and therefore everything's included. Sar even with nezek, and that's because we just don't use the klal uprat. Ben Azai Savar Danino Toba klal uprat. He says, when he says Chaburah ne'emra tchila, what he means is, well, because of the klal uprat, we go by the Chaburah part, which is going to be only if there's a bruise there or a wound. So now we have one question left to ask here. And then again, like I said from the beginning, according to the first reading, Ben Azai is the Tan of our mission. According to the second two readings, Rebbe is the Tan of our Mishnah, because he says, Tzar, without damages, you're going to be liable. The chitim chabura l'Rebbe lamali. So then, why does it say chabura according to Rebbe? If there's no klal uprat, why bother adding chabura? L'damim yaterim. Well, it's to teach you. Now, you pay tzar whether there is or whether there isn't a bruise. Right? A bruise means basically that you're also, let's say, I cut off your arm. So if I cut off your arm, you have a bruise, and now you can't do your work anymore, you know, and I have to pay the damages for that. And I have to pay the tzar, the pain that I caused you. So now they say, chabura, so why do you need chabura? Well, it's to teach you that you don't only pay the tzar, you also have to pay for the wound that I inflicted in you. So the fact that now you have a problem, I have to pay for that. In other words, you might say, that's obvious, of course you pay damages, but they're basically saying, no, you have to pay for the chabura and you have to pay for tzar. Don't think that tzar is in place of the damages. So now we have to figure out how we evaluate tzar. And this is quite complicated. Even though the Mishnah kind of stated it, it's going to be a little complicated to understand. So the Mishnah says, Omdim kama adam kayotze bazeh vortze litol. Right? We say, how much, if I could pay you money, I'll say, listen, I'm going to burn your hand and I'm going to burn your fingernail, according to the Mishnah. I'm going to pay you money. How much money would you be willing to accept to endure that pain of me burning your fingernail? Okay, it's a little bit strange to think about, but that's really the issue. So now they want to know, that's okay, because theoretically you might be willing to endure pain that doesn't have any lasting effects on you. Okay, in the end, right, it doesn't cause you any problem with your job or anything else. But tzar b'mkom nezek hechi shemina. Now they want to know, so we just established there's such a thing as tzar shalom kom nezek, tzar bim kom nezek. So now we want to talk about, and this will be a lot of our topic for today, these payments, the five payments in general, the four payments with damages, without damages. We're going to talk about this a lot. Now, how do we assess tzar when there is damages? Amar avua de Shmuel. So the father of Shmuel said the following. Omdim kama adam rotze litol likto alo yado. Period. Likto alo yado. So then we say, let's go ask someone, how much money would you be willing to accept? Well, same thing, right? How much money would you be willing to accept if I cut off your arm? To which the Gemara says, L'tolo yado. First of all, if we assessed how much money would you take for this? So first of all, that wouldn't be only tza'a, the amount. Lo tza'a l'chudehu, ha'kulu chamisha dvarim ika. It would be how much money you would have to say that amount is partly Sa'al, Nezek, Shevet, Ripoy, Boshet, right? It would include, when I burn your finger, all there is Tzar. But if I, your fingernail, but if I cause damage to a part of your body, like cut off your arm, I'm causing all five things. I'm embarrassed, you know, it's humiliating now, all these things. So now, Ve'od, and furthermore, and this is even more relevant, Bishukten Askina, we're talking about some crazy person. Who in their right mind would do that? Would accept money to get their arm cut off. No, nobody would ever do that. So there is no such thing. Ella liktoya doha ktua. Okay, so now we're going to talk about it must be a case where your arm wasn't working anyway, and now we're offering to amputate it. So they say, that doesn't help either. Yadoak tu anami lo tzar l'chudeika. First of all, it's painful to do that. And, but that's okay. There would be tzar. But, hatzar boshet ika. But there's also boshet. It's now humiliating. At least, you know, you have a ham there, even if it's not working. But when you take it off, that's also humiliating. And even it's more humiliating, it's not the not having a hand, but it's saying, diksifa le milta le mishka le bisre le mishte le klavim. Mi psaro le mishte le klavim. It's humiliating for you that they're going to take your arm now and throw it to the dogs. That's humiliating. So basically, if we come up with an amount, it's not going to tell us what tzar is because it's tzar mixed with boshet. So we're not going to be able to figure out how much for the tzar, how much for the boshet. So let's try again. Ela omdim kama adam rotze lito liktoa et yado hamuktav lamachut ben sam lesaif. Okay, this is... You read the news today, right? There was last night that Alabama executed someone for the death penalty with nitrogen gas, okay, which was a new thing, and they claim it's less painful. That was their theory. So now this is exactly what we're discussing here. How much would you take to use if they were gonna, let's say the malchut, right? That's usually the Romans about to cut off your arm, and but they were going to do it using some less painful method, like a drug that was going to make your arm stop working or something. And I said, listen, how much would you be willing to take to do it with a saif, with a sword? If I cut it with a sword, okay? I'll pay you if you're willing to endure more pain. And that's the amount you pay. Amre, hakanami lo shakilu mitzar nafshe. Nobody would do that. Why would somebody want more pain inflicted upon them? You can see how much they're struggling to figure out how on earth we can evaluate this. Ella, we're finally at the end now. Omdim, almost at the end, because we're going to have one issue with this. Omdim, kama adam rotze liten lektor lo yado amuktav lo machut ben saif for the sam. It's the opposite. The Romans, let's say, okay, want to cut off your arm with a sword. And, right, they've declared you need your arm cut off. We're going to cut it with a sword. And you come along and say, how much would you be willing to take? How much are you willing to pay? The opposite. How much would you be willing to pay for me to do it with a drug that's going to be less painful? So there's one problem with this. That's really going to be our answer. But the wording of the Mishnah doesn't work. Highly tall, lite mebaile. It says we evaluate how much someone would want to, would litol to take. But this is how much someone would give, right? Not to take. That was what we started off with, saying how much can I give you to endure the pain, you know, for you to endure the pain. But it's now, how much would you pay to endure less pain? So now they say, Amar Rav Huna, Hareid Rav Yeshua, litol ze mizeh mashanatan ze. In other words, what's the litol? The litol is referring to the fact, okay, let's say I injured you, and now I have to pay you tzal. So we assess how much you're going to get based on how much someone in the parallel situation would be willing to give to endure the pain. It's a weak answer, but that's how they explain it. And that's the only way they could really come up with how we could determine tzal. So in the end, it's defined as how much a person is willing to pay to have the same thing happen, right? To basically end up having their arm get, you know, kind of go out of use using a drug rather than a more painful method. And the difference is what we pay for tzal. It's kind of hard to assess, as you can imagine. Okay, repoy. Now we're moving on to repoy. So we're just quoting the Mishnah right now. Chikau chayav l'apot, right? If you hit someone, you have to heal them. And now we have to pay their doctor's bills. Now we're going to have a braita with three different opinions. And we're going to be talking about something that comes up, these smachim sha'alubo. We saw this before in the Mishnah. It's basically, okay, we'll see it soon. That, let's say you put a bandage on. You know, putting bandages on, right? There's always different opinions about, are bandages good or are they not good, right? They're good because they protect infection from getting in and other things when you have an open wound. On the other hand, they don't allow the space to breathe. And on account of that, you could end up with all sorts of things that grow there. So we're talking about some growth that was there, and we're going to see soon that we must be talking about that there was some bandage over it. And because you didn't have air, you bandage up the wound, and then it grew these things, which now you need to go to a doctor and get them fixed. Okay, some sort of, you say it's like some sort of boils or something that grows there. So Tanu Rabbanan, we're going to see three opinions about this. So because of that, on account of this wound, you have these growths, these boils. It starts to heal, but then it gets worse again. So you're liable. You have to pay. So if I did this to you and then you put this, again, we didn't talk yet about the bandage, but let's assume, put a bandage on and it gets, you know, you have some problem now on a result, as a result of that, I have to pay for your bills. And now that you're sick for longer and you can't go to work, I have to pay you shevet for that time as well. It's not on account of the wound. Only much later in the sugar we can understand what they're talking about. Obviously, if it, you know, it's on your other arm, so of course I'm not responsible. What are we talking about? But we'll see what they're talking about. Right now, let's just go with it. If it's not on account of the wound, that seems pretty clear and obvious. Not on account of the wound, then obviously you don't have to pay the repo, you don't have to pay the shevet. That's not the part that's going to interest us right now. The part is the first part. According to Tanna Kamma, if because of what, you know, something that happened as a result grew on account of this wound, you have to pay both the repo and the shevet for that growth. Rabbi Yehuda Omer, af machman makah chayav l'rapoto, ve'eino chayav l'iten lo d'mei shivto. He says, well, you do have to pay the doctor's bills for that wound that comes, the things that grew on account of the wound, but you don't have to pay for the extra days that I'm stuck at home because of it. That, the shevet, you don't have to pay. And chachamim omrim, shivto urefuato, kol shechaya b'shevet, chaya b'ripoy, she'eno chaya b'shevet, eino chaya b'ripoy. Shevet and ripoy go hand in hand. We'll see in a minute where he gets this from. And therefore, he goes back to Rabbi Yehuda and he says, you don't think there's shevet? If there's no shevet, then there's no ripoy. So we now have a three-way machlok. Do you pay shevet and ripoy for both? Do you pay both shevet and ripoy for this growth? According to Rabbi Yehuda, you pay only ripoy. According to the rabbis, you pay nothing. Hey, not shevet, not ripoy. So but my kamiflagate, what's the root of the machloket? And here the Gemara is going to mention this bandage. Now first, Rabbah is going to quote the rabbis from the house of Rav and say, they told me this, but I said to them, you're clearly wrong, and this is the way it should be understood. So we're going to have two different explanations. I'm a rabbi. I heard the rabbis in the house of Rabbi Yatve Bekamri. They were sitting and they said, their whole machloket is, should you put a bandage on a wound? Rabbanan savre makan itna le'eged. The rabbis say, yes, you should. The rabbis being the first, the Tanna Kamma. You should put on. And Rabbi Yehuda savar maka lo nitna le'eged. Okay, and then Rabbi Yehuda says, you're not supposed to put a bandage on. And because you're not supposed to put a bandage on, if you do, well, you're not going to be fully responsible. You know, then the person who caused the damage to your vision initially is not going to be fully responsible because you shouldn't have put the bandage on. Now, the problem is, so basically, let's just go through it. The rabbis hold, you're allowed to put a bandage on. So since you're supposed to, you know, and it's meant to have a bandage on it. So if you end up with some problem on account of the bandage, because now the space didn't breathe, it got very hot, you ended up with these boils, of course, they have to pay the repo and they have to pay the ship. That's very clear. Rabbi Yehuda says, well, you shouldn't put the bandage on. You did anyway, and it came because of the makah, so we're going to do repo, we're not going to do shepherd. We're going to make you pay the doctor's bills, we're not going to make you pay the shepherd. Why would there be this distinction? Well, he says like this. Now, the first thing you have to know is what the pasuk says. The pasuk says, we're darshaning this pasuk in Shmot chapter 21, verse 19, rak shivto yitein v'rapei yerapei. Rak, which means only, shivto yitein, you get the shevet, and rapo yerapei. Now there's a few different things going on in this pasuk. Shevet is mentioned once, rapo yerapei is mentioned twice, there's a repeat here of the language, and the words rak, the word rak, only appears right before shevet. So let's try to figure this out. Rabbi Yehuda Sabal, maka lo nitzna le'eged. Why? That's the first. We read that already. The maka is not supposed to be bandaged. Ripoy de tani be'ka mi'chayim. Shevet de lo tani be'ka lo mi'chayim. Now, even though you shouldn't have put the bandage on, since it came because of that, and since rapo yerepe appears twice, it means we're going to have a case of ripoy where you're not going to have shevet. That's why that one's doubled and that one's single. And that's why we're going to learn, you pay the doctor's bills, you don't do shevet. Now that was all Rav's, the students of Rav's explanation. Comes Rabbi and says, but you're totally wrong, I think. Amina Luana, I said to them, Rabbi Yehuda makes no sense according to this. If you're not supposed to bandage it, and you did it anyway, it's not my fault. I caused you an injury. And then you didn't deal with it properly, so I have to pay? No. if you're not supposed to put a bandage on, then you're not supposed to put a bandage on. It's not my problem. Ela, dekulei ama makanit nal eged. Everyone agrees you can't put bandages on. However, lo nitna le'eged yetera. But you're not supposed to put too much. In other words, you have to let some air get in. If you keep it too hot there, of course things are going to grow inside. So what happened here was the person did too much bandage. Now that's a little different than no bandage to yes bandage is a huge difference. More bandage to the average bandage is not such a huge difference. And that's where we're going to get to this in between of Rabbi Yehuda. So now Rabbi Yehuda saval, kevan de lo nitzna le'eged yetera, reported tani by kra, mechayev, shevet de lo tani by kra, lo mechayev. And that's why he's going to make this distinction. If you put on too much of the bandage, then we're going to say, okay, so then you'll still have to pay repoy because in the end, you were allowed to bandage it. It's just you did a little too much. But you'll pay the repoy, you won't pay the shevet. Now, where are the rabbis come off? The rabbis also think you shouldn't do excessive bandaging. So what do they say? Well, remember, we're talking about Tana Kamma here. That they were the most, they said, I have to pay everything. So they say, well, repoy you have to pay because of the double language. And shevet is right next to repoy in the pasuk. So whatever's true for repoy is going to be true for shevet. Why doesn't he do the hekesh? Because of the word rak. Only. Only is going to limit shevet. It's not in every case. Birabanan, what does they do with rak? Rak comes to teach you the shalom achmana makahudata. Well, rak is coming to teach you, you don't pay it if it's not on account of the wound, which again, we don't yet know what that is, so we're going to come back to that. Now, we just have to get to Rabbanan Batrai, the last opinion of the rabbis, which said no shevet when there's no repoy either. Rabbanan Batrai de Amre, kosh chaya b'sheva chaya b'ripoy, b'chosh chayeno chaya b'sheva neyo chaya b'ripoy. So what do they do with repoy de tanu be'kra lamali? Why do you have the double language? The double language makes it seem like there's something, you know, a little uneven or more likely you be chayav repoy. So at least the rabbis could say, well, the extra double, the first opinion says the double language means we're including an extra case when you put on this excessive bandaging, and then we'll include the shevet because it's right next to it. Rabbi Yehuda splits between the two, but the rabbis who say no shevet, no repoy, why is there a double language? So they're going to teach something super fascinating. Mebaile l'chadetanya, debay Rabbi Yishmael. They need it for a totally different drasha. Detanya, that was, they said in the house of Rabbi Yishmael, debay Rabbi Yishmael omer, v'rapo yerapei, mikan shenitan reshut l'arofe l'rapo. From here you learn that a doctor has permission to practice medicine. Why would we think a doctor wouldn't have permission to practice medicine? Right? It seems like a pretty obvious thing. Well, theoretically, you could think that doctors are counter to religion for all sorts of reasons, okay? First of all, whether a doctor can, first, some people say this also means that a patient should go to a doctor and not say, you know, well, God gave me this punishment, so I just have to live with it. Or the doctor is sort of playing God. If God gives you a punishment and you get sick, if you view all sickness as punishment from God, then if you say, well, I'm going to go to a doctor and he's going to fix this, well, you're basically saying, I don't want this punishment that God gives me and I'm going against God, you know, and the doctor, all the more so, is kind of acting like God and I'm healing people. God is the one who heals. So, Baruch, right, God is Rofe Cholim and all that. So what do you mean here? Maybe doctor is against our religion, is against our belief in God. So this is saying, no, that's not true. Okay, don't think of it in that way. No, God gave people the ability to heal themselves and to go to doctors and to be able to learn how to heal. So my daughter having started med school 2 weeks ago, it's a very interesting sugya to get to, right? It's a very fascinating topic. Yeah, we don't have more time for it, but it's a really interesting one. Okay, Tanu Rabbanan. So now we're going to have a braita that basically repeats some of the opinions we saw already. And then finally, we'll get to what is this lo machmana makah. So how do you know you have to, right, again, if it these boils came about on account of your wound, or, you know, you healed a little, but then it got worse again, you have to pay the doctor's bills, you have to pay the fact that they're not working. Okay, because of that pasuk, which has both shevet and repoy together, that's the Tana Kamma's opinion from before. You might have thought this would include even not on account of the wound, which we're going to have to explain soon. What is that? Tamuloma rak. Rak comes to exclude something. What does it come to exclude? It comes to exclude not because of the wound. Rabbi Yossi b'Rabbi Yehuda Omer. Now, this is the son of Rabbi Yehuda who spoke before, who was that in-between opinion. He says, af machman makap patul shenemar ra. You're also exempt on account, if it's on account of the wound, because it says ra. Now, there's two explanations of Rabbi Yossi and Rabbi Huda, whether he holds like the rabbis at the end of that braita, and he thinks you're totally exempt, or whether he thinks like Rabbi Yehuda, his father. So Ika de Amri, some people say, af machman makap patul the gamri, kirabana matrat. He means you're exempt entirely, both from ripoy and from shev. You're exempt from shevet, but you're liable to ripoy, kiman kavua, just like his father, Rabbi Yehuda. Oh, Amramar. So that was just a braita that we basically had two opinions instead of three, and then we said the second one is either like opinion two or opinion three in the last braita. Now we want to go back to this line that we didn't understand. You might have thought, right, this is Tanakama on account of the makah. You'd have to, if it's not on account of the makah, you would have to pay. Comes Rock to teach you, no. If it's not on account of the wound, then you don't have to pay the doctor's bills or the shev. To which they say, shalom achman makah ba'ikra. Why do you need a pasuk to teach you that? If you have, so let's say the wound was on this hand and I got a wound on the other hand. Okay, why would you need to pay for that? So in the case where I did it to you, why would I need to pay? Amre, my shalom achman makah. So they say, now what does this mean? What it means is, this is also very interesting. Kiditanya appears on the following bright. Harish avar divrei rofe. I injured you, and then you didn't follow the doctor's orders. Okay, so I paid for your doctor's bills, and then you didn't listen. This happens all the time, right? So what? This is a funny not listening. Achal dvash o komine metika. You ate honey or other sweet things. Mipnei she dvash v'chomine metika kashir lemakah. Everybody knows that eating honey and other sweet things is bad for these kind of injuries. These wounds, v'he'elama kato gargutni, and your wound brought gargutni upon you. Okay, we'll see in a minute what that is. Yachol yehe chayav l'rapoto. So you might have thought, in the end, it is because of the wound, but it's because you didn't listen to the doctor's orders. Talmud lama rak. So that means I don't have to pay for that. Okay, that's not my fault. My gargutni, amar abaye, nata krichta. That helps you, right? So it's nata krichta. The Quran says this is necrosis. Okay, which is basically where your flesh starts to die, like the blood doesn't get there properly and it dies. You end up with this dead skin. So I'm up, Maya Sute, how do you heal this? Ahala vikira vikalba. Okay, I'll go with the translation of the Quran. It's crystalline ice plant, wax, and wine dregs. That's what's supposed to heal this kind of thing. The Iamarle. Now here we're going to have all sorts of things that could happen between me and you. I caused you an injury and now I have to pay your doctor's bill. But I say to you, because I want to save money, what do I say? I'll heal you, okay? I'm either a doctor, or I'm not a doctor, but a self-proclaimed doctor. I know how to fix this. Amarle, you can say to me, you're like a lion praying, a praying lion, who's about to, a predator lion, okay? You're about to, what do you mean? You caused me a wound, Michelle, and now you want to try to heal me? No way, no how am I going to rely on you? And you can say, no, thank you. You know, you pay my doctor's bills. The Amarle, another option I could say to you. Maitina asti demagen bemagen. I'm going to bring you a doctor who does work pro bono, and he's just going to do it for free. Amarle, you could say to me, asti demagen bemagen shave. A doctor who works for free is worth nothing. Okay, basically, right? You get what you pay for. Thank you, but no thank you. The Amar, Maitina asti rechika. Even if I say I'm going to bring a doctor from afar. Amarle, asti rechika ena ivira. Someone who comes from afar causes blindness. Now, what does this mean? Okay, a bunch of different things. First of all, we all know that when you go to a doctor, you try to look for a reputable doctor, right? A doctor from afar, nobody knows about them. And not only that, but if you're a doctor in the city, you're going to be very careful to do things right because, again, this is, you know, not so fair the way they're talking about doctors, but you're going to make sure because you have a reputation to keep. If you're from far away, what do you care? You'll do something here. No one else from the nearby town is, you know, where you come from is going to hear because word didn't travel in those days very well. So, you know, there's no check system on making sure this guy's going to do a good job. And therefore, you don't have to accept that. Now we're going to do the reverse. Let's say you say to me, now you're the one who got wounded. And you say to me, right? It's right. I see you're writing. This is before online reviews. I mean, this is a fascinating topic in terms of thinking about all, you know, you can really understand the relevance of it. I said, listen, you give me the amount you would have paid the doctor. Sorry, you say to me, you know, give me the amount that I was going to pay a doctor and I'll just take care of it myself. So I can't let you do that. Why? You're going to do a bad job, and then I'm going to have to pay you more because you're going to have all these problems later because of it. No way, no how. You have to go to a doctor. I can insist. If you say, listen, I don't know how much the doctor's bills are going to cost. Let's just agree on a set price, right? Like you go into a taxi, you don't know how long, you know how much they're going to charge you on the meter. I want a set price. Okay? So can't do that either. Amarle, if you suggest I want a set price, why? Because I could say, Kosh came benafsha. You're just going to pocket the money possibly. And then what will happen? Currently shor hamazik. People are going to look at you, know that I caused your wound. You're not going to, like, you're just not going to go to the doctor, pay the bills, and you're going to end up with this terrible wound that's never healing. And people are going to call me an ox who gored because they're basically going to say, look at that person that you injured and look how terrible they look. And it's going to make me look bad. So I can insist that the money go to the doctor and not to, and we can't just work out a set price. Okay, very interesting issues. Tana, okay, now we're done with that issue. And now we're moving on to this general issue. We talked about sal bim kum nezek, sal shalom bim kum nezek. We're going to go back to this topic now. Whether you pay damages when there's damage, well, you pay all these four items when there's damages to pay also. And sometimes you pay them when there's no damages. So right now they're going to say the following. This braita says, v'kula mishtamim bim kum nezek. And we're going to do two things with this. The first thing we're going to say is, all of these, the four payments, Sal, Lipo, Shevet, Boshet, are all paid even when there's damages. That means, also, we can infer, which we're going to do in a little while, that they're all paid when there's no damages as well. Okay, because this is saying they're paid even when there's damages, really. So, the first thing we're going to do is, how do we know that they're paid in addition to damages? Because you might have thought, maybe they're only paid when there are no damages. So now we're going to find sources for these in the Psuki. Interestingly, we're only going to find for Tzal and Ripoy. The commentaries elsewhere say that Tosfa, for example, in the beginning, more earlier in the Masechta, when we saw one of these drashot, says that it's in the Adamu Ad Olam Sugyot, he says that it's from Tzar we can learn to Boshet and Shevet. Okay, so Rav Zvid says, Amakra, Petza Tacha Patza. This is the in between those Kviya and the Chabuah in that Pasuk. What do we learn from those extra words? Litain sal bim kom nezek. This teaches you that you're going to also pay for sal even when there's no damages. So they say, what do you mean? You might remember this, but that you might not remember this. But that was the source we used in the beginning of the Masechet in the Adamu Ad Olam Sugya to say people are always, whether it's shogeg, whether it's mezi, they're always responsible. We use petza tacha petza to teach that. So how can you teach this? Just like we had yesterday, yad b'yad, regel b'regel, should have said petza b'petza. Why did it say my petza tacha patza? Ta shma mina tarte. From there, you can learn two things. Now we're getting to rapo yerapei and the ripoy. How do we know there's ripoy even when there's no damages? Liten refua bim kom nezek. So this, I'm sorry, even when there is damages, you also have to pay, besides having paid the damage to the person that you cut off their hand, you also have to pay the doctor's bills. So they say, from rapo yerapeh, the double language. So now, obviously, we're going to have a problem because we already learned two different things from here. So first, they say, don't we need it for Rabbi Yishmael? Said, detana debe Rabbi Yishmael. This is where you get that doctors have permission to practice medicine. Well, if they want to teach you about the doctor, it should have said rofe yerapei. Shma mina litein refua bim kom nezek. So they're basically going to say rapo yerapei comes to teach you two things. The fact that they could have used one language and use a different language, that teaches you both. But now they're going to say akate mibayle lechadam aran, limine bekra biripoi. We already said, though, it doubled it by ripoy in order to say that even if something grows on account of the wound, right, and you did excessive bandaging, you're still going to pay ripoy. So how can we learn three things? Well, they're going to say, imkein lemakra, oh, rapo, rapo, oh, yerapei, yerapei. We did this with himatsei, timatsei, right? Should have, if they wanted to repeat, to learn a drasha, should have repeated the exact same word. The fact that they change it to a different word allows us even a third thing to darshan. This is rare that we actually get to three. Okay, so there's our two proofs, one by ripoy, one by tsa'al, that even when you pay damages, you also have to pay the additional payment. And like I said, some commentaries say that we learn the Shevet and Boshet from Tzah. Now, this is what I said before. You can infer then that they had to tell you specifically you pay it even when there's damages. It makes it obvious that even without damages, that's what we started today. The Tzar Shalom Kom Nezik. It wasn't so agreed upon about everybody, but from this bright, you can infer that definitely there are those who say that it's even without damages. So now they want to know, not where do we get it from, but Shalom Kom Nezik Hechi Mishkachalu. We want to find a case for Tzal, Shevet, Ripoy, and Boshet, that you did something without causing damages. Like, how could you have doctor's bills without having caused damages, right? In other words, there's a payment for nezek. We're talking about where there's no payment for nezek. You didn't devalue the person at all. So tzal, we already know because the Mishnah gave that example. In the Katani, as it says in the Mishnah. Tzal kva obashi put over masmail. You burned someone using a hot skewer or nail. Afilu al tziporno, even on your nail, where there's no damage to the body. Makom sheino asecha bula. Okay, that we got. Ripoy. Tavakadli midi vasalik. Va'aitele sama harifa. We get back to malpractice again. So what happened? You had some wound, not that someone inflicted on you, but or maybe that someone did, it doesn't matter. You went to a doctor, they gave you some very strong stuff. Va'achbere lebisra, and it caused a whitening of your skin. So now you go back to the doctor and you say, hey, listen, and whether it was a doctor or some person, it doesn't matter. And you say, hey, look, you caused me this issue. Now, this is something that you need a doctor for, you need medicine for, but it didn't devalue your you know, who you are. It's just a discoloration. Now he needs to give you something to basically restore the color of your skin. By the way, doctor's bill seems to include medication as well. That's what we're saying. You need some cream now to put up. Shevet, this is a funny one. Dehadke beindrona ubatle. You basically lock someone in a room and they couldn't go to work. That's damages that they can't go to work, but you didn't damage their body at all. Boshet, derakle ba'ape, you spit in somebody's face. That would be boshet. So these are all cases where you have the payment for one of the four things where there is no damage. Okay, now we're going to get to Shevet and how we pay Shevet. So in the Mishnah, it said, let's just go back. You pay damages. What are damages? Damages are, you once could work as this, you now can only work as this, right? We go evaluate what you would be on the marketplace now if you were a slave. And that difference from what you used to get for salary and what you now get for salary is what we pay you. Now, Shevet, we say we look at you as if we evaluate the days that you're now sitting in bed. We go by as if you're a Shomer Kishuim. Now, why did they choose a Shomer Kishuim? Cucumber watcher means you watch a field with cucumbers, because let's assume your hand was cut off. We'll see in a minute that it's going to depend on what injury you sustained, what the value of Shevet is going to be. If we cut off your hand, so you can't work the land anymore, but you could watch it because all you need are your eyes and your legs to walk around, and you have that. So the amount we deduct now for Shevet is based on what you could be working as now, and you're not working because you're in bed, because you're in pain from what I did to you. So Tanu Rabbanan, the Brayta says, Shevet, first that was just a quote from the Mishnah, now the Brayta is going to say the following. Shevet ruino toki iluhu shomer kishui. V'im tomar laktami datadin. If you say, wait, that's not fair. If you, and we talked about this before, if you were a hotshot lawyer who made a lot of money per hour, and now you can't work as a lawyer, what we're going to pay you is if you're a shomer kishuim, right? We called it like minimum wage before, but now we're going to see it's not exactly minimum wage. It's what you could do now. Okay, so a lawyer is not a good example here, because if you don't have a hand, you could still be a lawyer. Okay, maybe you have trouble typing, but you can have someone type for you. But let's say you were a baseball player, and now you can't work as a baseball player and because you don't have a hand, and now you won't want to work as a shomer kishuim. Right? That's about all you could do right now. So you said, that's unfair. Why would I be getting, now that I'm sitting at home, I'm not making my baseball salary. It's not like I'm not making my cucumber washer salary. In other words, now we're going to learn about the occupations and what was a higher paying salary in those days. So they're saying, you know, it could be if you had a hand, you'd be able to draw the water out of the well, or you'd be able to be a messenger and make more money. So why are we paying you as a Shomer Kishuim when, on account of this wound, you now can't make your higher salary of a drawer from the well or a messenger? Okay, apparently those were better paying jobs than a Shomer Kishuim. So they say, Midat Adin Lo Lakta, this is not unfair. Why is it not unfair? Shekfar Natano Dmei Yado Dmei Raglo, because The nezek paid for that, okay? The nezek covered that. The nezek basically covers the fact that you can never work again as a baseball player, okay? That is covered by your nezek. But now that you're stuck in at home for 5 days, now your future is as a shomer kishuim. So now you're not going to work as a shomer kishuim, but you're not losing any money basically because you already got that in the big nezek payment. So now we're going to get to what happens in all the, like, what would be your future occupation if the following happened to you? I'm a Rav. So Rav explains, katat yado noten lo dmei yado. The shevet, okay, so if, right, cut off your hand, you get the value of, again, what you were worth before, what you could have made before, what you make now. The shevet, when it comes to the shevet, ro'ino tokilu hu shomer kishuim. Okay, we knew that. That's not new. Shibarat raglo, if we break your leg. Now, you can't be a shomer kishuim if we break your leg because you have to walk around the field. So noten lo dmei raglo, you get the value for the fact that now you can't work in all sorts of jobs, right? And what you were working into what you can work now. And when it comes to shevet, ro'ino tokilu hu shomer at the petach. You can sit at a guard at the entrance. So that you could do. Simeate no, noten lo dmei no. The shevet, so again, you get the value of now that you can't see, what would you be valued at on the shuk? The shevet, ro'ino tokilu hu matchino berechaim. You can still grind grains, okay? You can grind things in the millstone. So that, you get your shevet based on that. Here show, but if you were made to be deaf, noten lo dmei kulo. You basically get all the damages in nezek. There is no shevet. Because at this point, you can't do anything. This is very fascinating. Why can't deaf people do anything? So first of all, you have to put yourself way back then. So according to, I think it's the Meiri, he says, a deaf person can't get instructions and therefore can't do work because no one can tell them what to do, right? In those days, they didn't write so much and they didn't, you know, they certainly didn't communicate in other, like nowadays, it's unbelievable the ways that you could communicate. They didn't have sign language. They didn't, right? So basically, they didn't have a way to communicate. Nowadays, this would be totally irrelevant because obviously blind people, deaf people can do lots of things. So that's a very interesting thing in terms of historically, you know, their viewpoint. Some people also, by the way, comment that if they were a smith and they had a talent that they could do even while deaf, right? You can see, if they had a skill, then they'd be able to continue the skill. What we're talking about is a worker that gets hired to do something. And since you have to tell them what to do, they can't do it. But if they had a skill already, they had learned a skill, then it would be a different story. Then this wouldn't be relevant. Okay, so it's very interesting in terms of what the, you know, even back then, you know, depending on where you lived and what was going on, you know, they had a way to say, oh, wait, this isn't totally true. Okay, this isn't totally applicable. But according to this, if you have no job, then basically you're going to get the whole payment of Nezek. And then there's no need for Shevet because that's already included all in the Nezek. So now we already saw there's different amounts for different injuries. So comes Rava with this long question that's going to end in a teku. Now we'll finish this up for today. Kitat yado v'lo amdu. I break your arm and they didn't assess yet how much I owe you. Shibarat raglo and then I break your leg. V'lo amdu. And they don't evaluate yet. And then I go and I blind you. Sime, they know, below I'm duhu, and they don't evaluate yet. Uliba self pircho, and then I cause you to go blind. It sounds like a pretty horrible situation. And then I cause you to go blind. Ma, mi amrina, kebanta lo amduhu, bachad umdana sagile. Since they didn't evaluate the damage at all the different points. So at this point, I basically turn you into someone who can't have a job. Viyavle to make kule bahade adade. And basically, I'll just give you the full payment of the damages at the very end. O dil machada chadam dinale viyavinle. Or do we have to say no? At this point, we have to assess all the different stages and I have to give you. Now, what do I have to give you though? Nafkamina what? What's the nafkamina here? Obviously, nezek is going to be that one whole payment. It's all the same. If I include, you know, it's this, I'm not going to pay you a million different payments. It'll obviously be, it's inclusive of all the others. But the pain and the humiliation, each time I did it to you, that was pain and that was humiliation. So perhaps I have to pay that for each one. Or do we say, right, so nihid nezek v'ripoy v'shevet, the nezek, ripoy, and shevet is all going to be the same. The chochad v'chad lo yavin alei. Kemen dekehav le tmei kule, so I already give you the full amount at the end. Kemen dekat le dami, it's as if I killed you, basically. It's as if you can't do anything yet. V'hayav le tmei kule, and I already gave you the full amount. But tzar boshet miyad de chochad v'chad yav, v'hav le tzar boshet. But do we say that when it comes to the pain and the humiliation, that was at each stage, it was new, it was a whole additional thing. The imtim tzalomar, and if you want to say kevin deloam duhu kayav le dmei kule ba'adadadi, since look, they didn't assess it all the way, and at the end, they do the assessment at the end, we just do tzar and boshet of one, if that's what you want to say, again, we don't know, but if you would say that, Amduhu mahu. What if they did assess at each stage, but I didn't pay you yet? And now we get to the end after I've done all those things, even though they assess, do I still have to pay every separate one? Mi amrinan kevanda amduhu chad chad abay lemei tavalei. Since they already assessed, I have to pay you for each one. O dilma kevanda lo shalim yav leit mekule. Or because I didn't pay, maybe now I kind of won out and all I have to do is pay this one lump sum in the end. Teku. We don't know the answer. Okay, so what did we do today? Okay, the next part's going to start a whole new thing. We'll see that in tomorrow's daf. I'll just tell you that they're going to ask about the shevet, but they really mean nezek. It's a little bit confusing because shevet and nezek are very similar. Shevet means what I'm devalued, right? I can't go to my job now. And nezek is what I'm devalued in the marketplace. So what they're going to talk about, the next question that they're going to ask is, in case you don't do it with me, I'll kind of give you a heads up. I know it's Shabbat, some people learn on their own. It's a little bit confusing. What they're going to talk about is if I cause you temporary damage. So right now in the shuk, your value will go down, but it's not going to go down for the long term. So do I have to pay you nezek for that, your value in the that you lost in the shuk temporarily? That's all an interesting question. Okay, so what did we do today? We started with the sar shalom kom nezek in our Mishnah. Who does that go like, Ben Azai or Rava, Rebbi? And we saw three different interpretations of their machloket. Then we went to, how do we assess sa'al? How do we figure that out? That was a bit of a crazy sugya of what you'd be willing to endure for all sorts of things. Then we said ripoy. We had this three-way machloket about the ripoy and the if you covered it, bandage it up too much, excessive bandaging, right? And then what do we make you pay for? Or do we make you pay at all? Then we had, what's the shalom achman makah, right? Which is you didn't listen to the doctor, and then all sorts of things about who can insist what from the other side about the doctors, the medical bills. Then we went to the, what's the source that all these things are paid even when there's damages? Then we said, what are the cases where you pay these four things without there being damages? And then we went to this question of Rava. Then we went to Shevet. How do we determine Shevet based on, right, what salary you're going to make if you don't have a leg, if you don't have an eye, if you don't have an arm, all that. It's different for each person. And then what if you did all those things to one person, one after the other, and they didn't assess, or if they did assess but didn't pay, what do we say? And that was left without an answer. With that, wishing everybody a Shabbat Shalom and hoping for good news. Hard to talk about these very graphic, violent actions in a time like this. Anyway, with that, wishing everyone a Shabbat Shalom.